We can modify the direction so that it's all coming out of S. Capacities for all this are going to be 1. Same thing for all this. It's all 1. Okay? And of course, you can also add directions from xi to yj. So all these directions were not there before, but in the process of converting the problem to a network flow problem, we'll be adding directions. Same thing for all of this y nodes, you'll be connecting them to the virtual destination. So these are extra added nodes and edges. So without going through too much of the details, intuitively, what would you do? I mean, whenever that you pick a flow, what does that mean? You are making a decision of one or multiple matches. Okay, so let's go through the example of constructing the residual graph again. So for the residual graph, we're going to copy this. This is S and X1, X2, X3, X4, X5. This board focusing algorithm of this graph again. This is our G star, right? Our residual graph. And this is our G. In the beginning, it's actually kind of boring. It's whenever that you pick a path, it's going to be the path that's always pointing to the right, right? Because that's all the edges are. But as the process, as the algorithm actually proceeds, new edges are going to be created on this residual graph, right? Because of the direction that you can actually cancel the flow. So let's try this again. You should have this red. Represent path. So let's pick a random path. So start from S, goes to X4, for example, then Y4. Yeah, that's the only path. Y4, and then T. S, X4, Y4, T. So whenever that you have this path, it's basically saying that you're going to make some matches, right? So flow this network with unit one flow. So that is equivalent to saying that you're going to pick this as a match. You're going to match X3 to Y4. Well done. What's that? What that was around? X4 Y4. That is supposed to be black. Well, for the sake of completeness, I'm going to change all of it to red. So that's my flow. And as a result, I'm going to change my residual graph, right? So that I'm going to create a new edges going back from X4 to S, that's going to have capacity 1, and capacity of the original link is going to be down to 0. So that, what does that mean? You can, that means you can't really select or use export anymore, right? And it's not directly coming from S to export. Again, that's going to be 0. That's going to be 0. And same thing for Y4. Now we're going to have this going back with capacity 1. So let's try X2. I think X2 is more interesting because it has many more options. So let's have the second choice of S, X2. Where do we want to go? Maybe Y2 and T. Okay? And that's going to be the same. I'm going to change this. Thing, I'm going to match X2 to Y2. And for this, I'm going to have this direction, this extra direction back to X2, T to Y2. Pass to 1. And all of these are going to be reduced down to 0. 0, 0, 0. Make sense? I'm doing nothing but just applying this. Yes.
Because X2 is connected to Y1 and Y3 as well, does that like constrict the flow or something like that?
Well, I guess
you made it sound like if X2 is connected to 3 other nodes.
No, I'm just saying that it's a more interesting node that we might be able to actually.
Why is it more interesting?
It's just more option.
Oh, right.
Oh, okay.
So but for X4, you can only connect to Wi-Fi. There's no other options.
But all the options are identical, right? I mean, there's more options, but they're. I'm just making sure, like, I'm not missing. Like, I'm making sure that there's not constraints here. That it's just options. That's it.
Yeah,
there's a different route you can take. Okay.
All the ways are one, right?
Yeah, all the ways are one. Either 0 or 1 is the residual graph, right?
Okay. So this is the residual graph. What do you call the other graph?
That one?
Yeah.
That's your input graph.
Input residual, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
But having more options is a good thing, right?
Well, it's a bad thing for you.
Always it is.
But it's a good thing for us to look at more, I mean, interesting examples. So the next path we can pick would be, for example, so we will be always picking the path from the residual graph, even though it's always pointing at that. Anything else we can do? Any other path? So maybe we can. So we can't really go from S to X2 anymore. S to X2, we can go from S to X1. And then.
Y3.
Y3, okay. S to X1 to Y3, then to T.
Last question. That X2 to Y2.
So the point so far is that the choices that we made are kind of arbitrary, right? Just like the network flow that we did last time. We picked this path because it exists in a graph. There's no optimization. You're not picking the shortest path or whatever. We just pick a path. The point is that since you have all these different directions, hopefully later we will see a case that some of these matches that we have right now, so right now we basically are saying that X1 needs to match to Y3, X2 to Y2, X4 to Y4. Right? These are kind of like arbitrary choices. But hopefully later on we'll see that some of these matches are going to be corrected in order to actually accommodate more matches. So I don't think I actually flipped anything here yet. I'm going to do that. So flipping back and then Y3. That's Y3. Back to 1. And then this back to sure that. Y3 to X1. Is X3 and
X5 to Y5, right?
X5, yeah. Why is it this still one? What is that one? I guess
it should be 0.
Yeah, that should be 1 and that should be 0, right? So that's X.
X3 to Y1 and then X5 to Y5.
Y4. Back to X4. Back to S. To X5. That work? So S to X3, that's valid. But the only option from X3 to something is going to be Y4, right? And Y4, you got stuck. What can we do? Well, go back, right? This is red. Get back to X4. Then we can go back to S. That's a loop. Oh my god. What does that mean? Then you can, if you want to have a simple path, I guess you can go up to X5. And since you have been X4, right? The only option for X5 is Y5. Then to D.
So will we count that or just eliminate this, the loop and go from S?
Yeah, but so basically that's. Let's not eliminate the loop, I mean, that's basically eliminate the matches that you made earlier. So this is saying that I'm going to go from S to X3, right? So in that case, I'm going to make a connection of 1 here, and the same thing here. So that becomes 0, 1, 0, right? And then I go back along this red line. I use the capacity of this red line, the capacity of red line becomes 0, capacity of blue line becomes 1. Right? I'm reversing the matches. In this case, it's 0, 1 again. And since now I'm traversing X5, this becomes 0 and back age of capacity 1. Right? Same thing here. 1, 0, 0, 1. So what that does for you in this graph is basically saying that I'm not going to send anything, or I'm not going to match Y4 to X4 anymore. Right? So it's going to be black again. Instead, I'm going to have X3 matches to Y4, and as well as matching X5 to Y5. Does that give me more matches? Right, so this is going to be your final answer. You're going to have this one, X1, Y3, X2, Y2, X3, Y4, X5, Y5. That's your answer. So, no matches. key idea is very simple, right? Once you have the problem by time matching, you add these two nodes and you augment the capacities of one to all the edges that you created, right? Your start is going to connect to all the X nodes. Your go is not going to connect to the all the Y nodes, and that's all. You'll see a lot of similar things in all of this set of problems that we're going to talk about later. So if not, we are going to move on to the second problem, which is called H disjoint path. This is a different variant of more common disjoint path, which is trying to avoid duplications in the vertices. And this happens to be an easier version of the problem. So given a graph, and giving you a star node and also a go node, you want to find all paths connecting S to T. And you also want to have the property that all of these paths are different enough that they don't share a single edge. So no edges are going to be shared by two paths or multiple paths. Okay. So that's the problem. How do you solve the problem? I don't really have an example in my hand, but you can just imagine any of the graph, basically graph that has this is your graph. Well, it's a direction like that. You can move that back, backwards. No. Yeah. So the question is how many paths that you can have being disjoint, H disjoint path that will connect S to T? Okay, so that's the question. The two versions of the problem, first version is easier. That your graph is directional. The directions of the edges are given to you. Another version is that assuming that your graph is undirectional, there's no directions on the graph, how would you solve the same problem? Okay. So let's talk about this, the first version, directional graph. And this is very similar to the standard flow problem. There's no flow per se, but you've got a starting node, you've got a destination node, right? Your goal is to find path connecting them, and your goal is to count how many of this kind of path. How do you do that? The only thing that's missing is, of course...
Yeah, can we just like give every edge one capacity,
yeah. Capacity is the only thing that's
we
missing.
Do the same thing that we have at part
and
of
the since
connection.
Capacity is one, the flow that you send over can only use an edge once. Right? Once the flow is sent over, you cannot reuse that edge anymore. So what you do is basically augment the input graph with edge capacity one. So step number one, set of each input to one. So next flow problem.
Okay.
Right. So what would be your answer, right? What is going to be the answer of this graph? That what is the number of inch disjoint path that you're looking for? Number of a disjoint. The maximum flow. Okay. If you can send 3 units of flow in this case, for example, you are going to have 3 disjoint paths. Because whenever that you send a flow, it's going to basically remove the edges in the residual graph. And when you try to find another path in the residual graph, the new path is not going to have overlapping edges with the previous path that you discovered, right? So I'm not going to repeat this process again, but basically what you do is the same thing. You copy this again to create this G star, your residual graph. You find a path in the residual graph. Once you have the path, you reverse the directions of the edges, right? And repeat until there's no path in the residual graph. That's it.
So you keep going from S to T and then back to S and then back to T, taking all different paths each time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Here's a question for you. What happens if you have undirected graph? For 2 undirected. What if you don't have directions? No directions anymore.
I mean, you give it a direction, right? And you make it a weight 1, and then the residual is going to be towards one way, and the other graph is going to give you the other way. So.
Say that again, sorry.
You give it a direction, right?
Give it a direction?
Yeah, like either
the
way.
Arbitrary direction?
I mean, like then you do both of the graphs, you know, either way, both graphs point the different directions.
I guess close enough, but not exactly right. Yeah, assigning directions. Yeah.
Sign direction.
Well, by direction, well, undirection means by directions, right? You can go both ways. So instead of having one edge, you can actually duplicate the edge with both directions. So again, it's pretty simple. When it's undirectional, you can just create that. Each of them has capacity 1. Now the graph becomes directional. It just happens to that each pair of nodes has 2 directions, and each direction has a capacity of 1. This is going to be exactly the same as before. So, on the record, that's easy. Make it directional. And by duplicating the edges.
You can't send flow over at the same time, though, right? Like if you have S and B, you just have a flow going from S to B and at the same time.
You can, that basically means
you can do that.
The flow.
Okay, that's allowed, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, anyway, that's the case. Alright, so get rid of this. Moving forward 5 degrees, yeah, that's good. So the next question is actually more interesting. The next question is also a generalization of the network flow problem. What you have is going to be, what happens if you have multiple source? What happens if you have multiple destination, right? Instead of one source, one destination. And to make the problem more interesting, the circulation and demand problem also provides input of supply and demand. Since you have multiple sources, each source might provide different quantity, different number of units to send out over the network, right? And different destination might require or request different number of units in order to produce something. So in this separation of a problem, we're going to have, let me see, the circulation and demand. No, this is not a optimization problem. This is a problem of satisfaction. So you're trying to check whether or not this network can satisfy a certain requirement. Okay. So sometimes it's called feasibility problem. So now an optimization problem. Going to be something that we'll cover next. Okay. This is typical MP hard problem. Find a solution so that you can satisfy certain constraints. This is typically very difficult. But we'll see that because of the special properties, we are going to find some very efficient algorithm to solve them. So here is the definition of the problem. It's basically a set of suppliers. These are nodes in the graph. Supplier nodes. And a set of receivers. Sorry, again, a bunch of nodes. Another definition is that each node has a demand. Each node, let's say this node is called V, the demand is going to be D sub V. Okay. So this is a value. I'll put this value in the node. Right? It becomes a property of the node. There's several cases that you have to consider. D sub V is smaller than zero, D sub V is greater than zero, or D sub V is zero. Okay. So in this case, when D sub V is a negative number, that means V is a supplier. It's a negative demand. It's actually sending something out. It is a receiver. And then, or sync, right? We've been using the word sync or sources. It's a source. These are the three possible cases. You can't really have anything else other than this. So again, these are still just the definition of the problem. And we're not doing or solving anything yet. So like the network flow problem, we are going to have constraints. Sending the flow out, like the network flow problem. But you're not trying to maximize the flow or minimize the cut. What you're trying to do is, once you have this definition of the problems, some of the nodes are either source node or sink nodes, and some of the other nodes are going to be the regular nodes. It's not sending anything out or receiving anything. So we call them regular nodes. Once you have the definition of the problem, what you want to do is, want to check whether or not there's a flow that will satisfy all of these properties. So you're going to have a constraint, very similar to whatever the constraints that you see in a network flow problem. The constraint is that the flow sending over an edge of the graph is going to be smaller than capacity of the edge. Okay? By definition. And that's going to be greater than zero. Right? So we have seen that before. This is the same as before. The second constraint is coming from this flow conservative. Okay, but depending on the type of nodes that we have been defining here, you might have different flow conservative, right? But it turns out that you can just write down the conservative term in one single equation. So the inflow of a certain vertex, regardless what type of vertices you're talking about here, minus the flow out of V is going to be dV. Right, if you think about V as being a source basically is a node that is not receiving anything, it's always sending out something, right? So its in is going to be zero minus something negative, right? So it's going to be sending out something. In the case of a regular node, your dV is going to be zero. That means whatever that you're receiving, you must be sending them out. You're not storing anything at the node. Right? Same thing for the sink nodes. Out is zero, and the flow is going to be exactly dV.
dV is the capacity.
What is dV again?
dV is the flow. What?
Is dV like the total flow?
No, dV is a user input.
Oh, okay.
It's
okay.
Part of the input. So every node is going to have a dV. But defining the flow, defining the problem with dV.
Okay. Isn't the max flow the capacity, though?
The maximum flow the capacity? No, the maximum flow is the flow.
Okay. But they're the same number. One's 11, the other.
Right. So the problem is to solve. To check whether or not, for this given input, can you find a flow to satisfy all these constraints? Right. So the algorithm is really simple again. Here's the algorithm. Step number one: add a fake node, or you can say this is a super source node. Say a fake node S star, right? And connect S star to all source your input, okay. The regular graph, and each of this node is going to have capacities as well, right? Along the edges. Again, something random. 5, 7, 9. 10. Right? So that's the regular flow problem. But in addition to that, you also have this D sub B for every single limb. Use another color. So let's add another edge that's more interesting. So these are the capacities that you have, the network property, right? How thick the pipes are, right? For every node, there's also another number. I was trying to use green, actually. So this might be number of units of something that this city or this factory can produce, right? So 4 units of iPhone this facility A can produce. And I have 2 trucks from A to G, 3 trucks that I can bring my iPhone from A to D, right? So it needs to be negative, so I'm going to say -4. It's a producer, it's a source, right? -8, maybe. So that's a receiver. So all these regular nodes are going to be zeros, right? And I can say this is actually a destination. So it's going to store 3 units of goods there, and 4, and 2 here. Okay, so that's the input that you will get for this particular problem. Okay. And like I said, the first step is to add a supernode called S. What color is still not using? So I can use the blue node. S star. So at this step, I'm talking about the algorithm trying to solve this circulation problem, right? So all of these are your input. I'm going to add a new node called S star, and I'm going to add a new node called T star. I'm going to connect S star to all the sources, in this case A and B. I'm going to connect my receivers to this super receiver, right? So that's step number 2. Add a fake now T star.
Are those like similar to linked list dummy nodes where they just
Yeah, so very similar to the bipartite matching that we have been doing, right? I think this is SNT. And connect all things, all sync nodes to T star with capacity D of V.
That's positive, right?
Yeah, that's positive.
And the other one is negative.
Yep. So in our case, the capacity from S star to A is going to be, well, negative of the demand.
So it's 4, right?
To be 4, right? 4. 8, 2, 4, 3. Okay, all the screens are the D of F, right? Demand from F, demand from E, demand from D, right? Same thing here, demand from A, demand from E, so on and so forth, right? So the same thing for those two. There's no demand for it. So step number 3. Solve max flow problem. can we do? We solve the network for flow problem from this graph, right? This modified graph. We get the flow. We get the maximum flow. Well, what do we do with that maximum flow? Max flow f. So if this maximum flow equals summation of all the supply, right? For supplying 4 here and 8 here, then I'm saying that the problem of circulation with demand is satisfied. If they're different, then the problem is not satisfied. So if this f equals the demand v, all sources v. I guess I'm to put a minus here, right? Because demand for sources are negative values. So if this sentence is correct, it's true, then the circulation problem is satisfied. It's a feasible problem that you can actually solve. And the way how you solve it is, well, by looking at the flow that you just calculated, right? Okay. So let's take another break. If you have nothing else to do, maybe you can actually solve this, right? Since this is just another maximum flow problem. Copy it, create a residual graph, and send the flow over it.